Good morning and welcome. It's good to see everybody here today. We've still got some more folks straggling in, but we're going to get ready and get started as soon as we can. And so let's get ready to worship our Lord. Go ahead and stand as we prepare to sing. Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this day and this opportunity to worship you. Father, I pray for those that are not here today, those that are not feeling well, those that are traveling. Father, put your hand upon us. Protect us from the virus. Protect us from all the other illnesses and the evil that is in this world. Lord, be with us today. We thank you, Father, and we pray that you will just bless this time. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Click on the big screen and push down.
We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of your mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of your mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry,
Father, we are here today to worship you, and we do cry holy, for you are holy. You are King of kings and Lord of lords. And Father, we worship you, and we love you. We just ask you to touch us today. Speak to our hearts and to our minds. Grow us and make us into who you created us to be. Help us, Lord, to focus on you. Don't let anything distract us. Don't let anything pull our attention from you, because we are here today for you. Watch over us, Father. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Go ahead and be seated. It is great to see everybody this morning. Just a few things we want to touch on. We are still trying to follow up with some of our Easter egg packs that we gave out, and we are trying to keep in touch with some of the people. We're hoping we can reach out to them. So keep those packs in your prayers, because a lot of times those kits like we gave out, they can be almost like time bombs. They don't explode right away. They don't have an impact on people's lives right away, but they can soon. It might be a few weeks. It might be a few months. They might come across the tracts or the information on the church just at a time of need. Maybe there's been a death in the family or marital issues or something, and they'll go, okay, maybe we'll look at God. So keep praying about the families that got those kits and the families that got those things. Also pray that they enjoyed everything. I'm going to be talking about this some more in the coming weeks, but I just want to kind of try to whet your appetite for it. We're going to be doing a different type of ministry this summer. You're going to want to be involved in. It's going to involve us on Sunday afternoons after church. It'll be good. It'll be fun. We've even gotten some assistance from the Northwest Baptist Convention to do this. Like I said, I'll be giving you more information in the weeks to come, but this is something that is very exciting. And like I said, it's something that the convention is even taking interest in to see how it goes. So be praying about our summer ministry, our summer of fun. Let's go ahead, let's stand, and let's continue to worship and to praise and to sing. Hi.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glory. Take away. Rejoice in this holy day.
And this new series is on Love Your Neighbor. We're shifting gears now and looking at one of the greatest commands found in the Bible. We're going to be looking at the theme, Love Your Neighbor. We're going to start today in Matthew chapter 22. In Matthew 22, the Pharisees sent a legal expert to test Jesus because they did not like Jesus and they were hoping that they could trap him in something that they could use against him because the crowds were following Jesus and the crowds were loving Jesus and the crowds were hanging on his every word, unlike the way they treated the Pharisees. And so they were hoping they could trap Jesus in something, get him to say something wrong or something controversial so that they could then turn the people against him. And the expert asked Jesus, what is the most important commandment? Now, I know that when you think of Old Testament and you think of commandment, you immediately go to the Ten Commandments. That is the bedrock foundation of which everything in the Old Testament is built on. It was the basis for all of Israel's rules and laws throughout their history. God gave the Ten Commandments to Israel as a nation before he gave any of the other, literally hundreds of commandments. And so we think of the Ten Commandments, and the legal expert was probably wanting Jesus to pick one of those Ten Commandments and say, this one is by far the most important, in which case what Jesus would be saying is the other nine, they're not on the same level. And so, with this kind of a trap thrown before him, Jesus went completely off script. He didn't go to the Ten Commandments in any way. Instead, he went and said, the most important commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. And the second is like it. In Matthew 22, verse 39, Jesus said, the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. So today, we're going to look at this command that meant so much to Jesus and see how it applies to us and to our neighbors. Jesus said, after he gave these two commands and said, these are the most important, he said, all the laws and all the teachings of the prophets hang on these two. You start with these two, and everything else can be tied back to one of these two. And so we're going to look at this command, and we're going to start off with the question, who is your neighbor? That's a legitimate question. Who is your neighbor? When we think of neighbor, usually we think of the folks that live next to us or across the street from us or behind us or, you know, maybe in our general neighborhood, maybe, you know, as far as you can throw a rock and hit their house. But that's not who Jesus defined as neighbor. And that's not the definition we're going to be using either. The definition that we're going to be using for neighbor is your neighbor is anyone you can help. Anybody you can help is your neighbor. This was taught to me by my best friend's mom when I was going to their Sunday night children's stuff. That's what she said, and it has stuck with me ever since. Your neighbor is anyone you can help. And it's interesting because your love for your neighbor is tied into your love for God. Your love for your neighbor is tied to your love for God. The most important commandment, the first commandment, is to love God with all you are. And the second command is to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, if you love God with all that you are, and you value what God values, you will love yourself greatly because you know that your Lord, your God, your Creator loves you greatly. And if you love yourself greatly, you're going to love your neighbor greatly. So these two commands, though when you read them separately, they sound completely unrelated, they really tie together very, very well. They tie together very well. So if you are obedient to these two commands, you will love your neighbor just like you love your God, with all that you are and with all that you have. So this leads us to another question and to our next point, which is, how do we love ourselves? This is a very legitimate question, especially if you are one of the types of people of which I am, was, have been much of my life, a person with very low self-esteem. How do you love your neighbor as yourself if you don't really care for yourself? Well, let's get it into just some nitty-gritty, the practical aspects of this. Okay, first of all, you love yourself by respecting yourself as God's creation. You may not have a lot of self-esteem. Okay, I've shared before about my struggles with low self-esteem and the causes behind it. But the simple fact is, no matter what you may think of yourself, God thought enough of you that before you existed, He chose to create you. And He thought enough of you and loved you enough to send Jesus to pay the price for your sins. God values you greatly. God values you greatly. This is evident throughout the scriptures. God says in Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans, the thoughts that I think towards you, plans to give you a future and a hope. God would not be giving you and thinking towards you positive things and beneficial things and wanting to give you a future and a hope if He didn't care about you. If you were not valuable to Him, He would not waste His time on you. You are valuable to God. In 1 Corinthians 2:9, it says, quoting from Isaiah in the Old Testament, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has entered the hearts of man all the things God has prepared for those who love Him. God has prepared amazing things that you can't even begin to imagine. You haven't seen them, you haven't heard them, you can't imagine the wonderful things God has prepared for you. And He wouldn't prepare these wonderful things for you if you were not valuable. So you need to respect yourself as valuable to God. You are His valued creation. God created us, each of us individually. He values us individually. He values you for who you are and for what you have to say and for what you can be, because He created you to be something special. I heard it said like this, and it really spoke to me. It said, before God created you, He knew everything you would say, everything that you would do, everywhere that you would go, and God thought enough of you that He created you anyway. He loved you enough, He created you anyway. Even knowing the mess ups you were going to make. Or I've also heard it said this way. God looked at His creation, all of creation, the entirety of the universe. And He said, do you know what this universe needs? It needs you. I'm going to make you. I've got a spot for you. respect yourself. How do you love yourself? You start respecting yourself. And if you don't feel good enough about yourself to respect yourself as you are, respect yourself as God's valued creation. And then the next thing that we do, that we love ourselves. How do we love ourselves? Speaking in just general terms here. But you meet your needs. We need food. We need shelter. We need water. We need companionship, fellowship. We need these things. You provide them. You provide them for yourself. You take care of yourself. When you're sick, you try and get some medicine. You take some aspirin, you go to the doctor, whatever you do. When you're hungry, you eat. Because you know you need to. When you're thirsty, you drink. Because you know that your body needs water. So you meet your needs. And not only do we have these physical needs, but science and psychologists and psychiatrists have showed us that we have social needs. We have emotional needs. We need relationships. We cannot be alone. Now, because of the viruses, because of the lockdowns, because of everything, we're having to maybe spend a lot more time at home, a lot of time alone, but still, we need interaction with people. That is why, without a shadow of a doubt, Sunday is my favorite day of the week, because I get to see my family, my entire church family. And when people are absent, it hurts. I miss them. And I'm always hoping every Sunday, and I'm praying that there'll be more for the family to add, because I love our church family. We are a family. We're a family. We care about each other. We do what we can to help each other. I've never heard anybody say, hey, I need help with X, Y, Z, whatever, and everybody say, too bad, so sad, you're on your own. No. We work together, we pull together, we help. Relationships, we need relationships. God created us to need a relationship with Him, to desire a relationship with Him, and to desire a relationship with others. God created the entire universe. He created the world, He created light, He created the water. He created the plants and the animals. He created Adam. And He looked at this every day. God looked at His creation and said, it is good. Except, He said, it is not good for the man to be alone. Because we were created for relationships with each other. And we provide these. We're created and hardwired to desire a relationship, to worship. And if we do not worship the one true God, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords that we've sung about, then we're going to invent our own. And history is full of cultures that invented their own gods. And history is full of people who worshipped, who went to all kinds of extremes for these gods. And it's not that different from our world today. We have people who have invented their own gods. Only they don't act like they did 3,000 years ago. But then today, most of the invented gods are the god of self, the god of pleasure, the god of possessions, God of money. These are the things that we worship today. We don't gather in groups and sing songs of and hymns of praise to money. We don't bow down and pray to a pile of money. But we do make it the number one focus of our life. We do sacrifice time energy. We sacrifice people. We sacrifice relationships for this God or for that other God. No invented God will ever satisfy us the way a personal relationship with your Creator will satisfy you. Jesus talked about that in John chapter 4, verse 14. You might want to write that down and look that one up. John 4, 14. So, we've looked. Who is our neighbor? Anybody that we can help. How do we love ourselves? We respect ourselves as God's creation, valuable creation, and we meet our needs. So, how do we love our neighbor? We're talking in very general terms here, because every person needs to be loved in a different way. Every person needs to be reached out to in a different way. But how do we love our neighbors? Well, we meet them and we get to know them. We meet them and we get to know them. That's going to be part of what this summer of fun is going to be about. Part of it, and like I said, we'll be finding out more and more in the coming weeks, but part of the plan is for us to go after church on Sundays when the weather is good, which should be most of the summer, at least a couple of times a month, go to a local park. Go to a park. And set up grills and start cooking. And if there are people in the park, go talk to them. Go play ball on the basketball court. Go throw a frisbee around with them. Go walk around and just say, hey, we're cooking burgers and hot dogs over here. Come and have some. And we're going to be cooking hot dogs and hamburgers and asking anybody in the park to come and join us. We'll meet them. We'll talk to them. We'll get to know them. We'll share food with them. We'll invite them to come to Jesus. We'll invite them to come to church. But we're going to get out in the community. And we're going to go to a different park every week. Now, we might go to a park a couple of times. There might be four parks around, and we'll go to one, and we'll go to one, and we'll go to one, and we'll go to, then we'll go back to them. But we're going to go to different parks. Many of our parks around here are small community parks. They're really nice. The one thing that we're going to have to watch is some of them do not have bathrooms, so you'll need to go before you go. And it will also make sure that generally we're there an hour or two, and that'll be about it, but that'll be fine. And so this is our summer of fun, meeting people and getting to know them. Get outside these walls, go to where the people are. A couple of weeks ago, when the weather was nice, Brenda and I went to one of the parks, had a picnic. There was a group of five teenagers playing frisbee. There was a couple of families with little kids. There was a family with a couple of kids playing basketball. The kids were like 2 and 4 maybe, so they weren't really playing basketball very well, but they were just having fun running around. And we got to talk to a couple of them, and you know, I just think it'd be great. And as I said, we've gotten some funding from the convention to help with the expenses of this. Not with everything, but that's okay. We can chip in some. But this is an opportunity to get out and try to meet people. This is going to be our summer of fun. And we're not going to do it every week. People have busy lives and schedules. We can't, you know, plan on doing it every week, but couple of times a month, we can go do this. And it'll be a wonderful opportunity to reach out to our community. This is going to be the summer of fun. The summer of family and summer of fun. And we meet their needs, okay? We meet them, we get to know them, and then we meet their needs. On those days in the park, one of their needs might be they're hungry or they're thirsty, and we'll have soda or Kool-Aid or water or something like this, and hamburgers and hot dogs, some chips, nothing extravagant. That's going to be it. Ketchup, mustard, maybe some relish, you know, nothing extravagant, but we're going to meet their needs. They might have other needs. They might have other needs that we can try to meet. Maybe they're having marital problems, and we can point them to Jesus, and we can talk with them and help them. Maybe they're having problems because they don't know what to do or what they might be faced with because someone in their family was just diagnosed with cancer. Well, those here that have had cancer and have had to go through chemo treatments, maybe you can sit down with them and say, hey, your experience will be different from mine, I'm sure, but this is what I went through. And you can offer them a word of encouragement and a word of hope. Maybe there's all kinds of problems and issues and challenges that people face in this world. And God's going to put you together with them because you can help them in some way. And so, we're looking forward to trying to help them with food, with clothing. We can get to our St. Pauli shed if need be. We can, you know, I don't know about how we can help with medicine or with housing, but maybe somebody can do something. I don't know. And we won't know until we get out there. We can help them have positive relationships. You know, one of the things that people who are stuck in addictions in particular, one of the things that they have the biggest problem with is they do not have positive, healthy relationships with anybody. Maybe we can be a start. We can be a positive, healthy relationship with them. And another way we meet their needs is we recognize their value to God. Just as you are valuable as God's creation, so they are also valuable as God's creation. And we cannot forget that. It's so easy for us today to look at people and overlook them because we don't see, we don't recognize that they are valuable to God. But they are. Just as God created you, just as God said the world needs you, this universe needs you in it, God said the world needs them in it as well. And so we recognize they are valuable to God. And this is how we love our neighbors. This is our opportunity to love our neighbors. We're going to be getting into greater detail over the next few weeks as to how to live out the command to love your neighbor. But for now, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you on the first step of the process. Meet people and get to know them. You don't have to know their life story. You don't have to know everything about them. You don't have to make a lifelong friend. But I challenge you to meet your neighbor, anyone you can help. Meet some people. Get to know them. When I went to college, I went to a very small college. We did not have a football team. We had a men's basketball team and a women's basketball team. The men's basketball team was on our college campus what the football team is on most college campuses. And they were the in crowd. Everybody loved them, especially because they were really good. And everybody wanted to know the basketball team, and everybody wanted to be friends with the basketball team. They wanted to claim they were friends with them. Well, this school is in southern Missouri. I grew up in Iowa. And it just so happened my freshman year, there was a kid on the basketball team that was a freshman that grew up 30 miles from me. And I got a chance to meet him. And we made friends and connections, and we made many trips to and from school together on Christmas break and Thanksgiving and all kinds of other weekends. And through him, I got an opportunity to meet the other basketball team players, and I got to know most of them pretty well. Before I started school, I had read an article about athletes and people that were fans and that fawned over them and all of this, and they asked them one question. They said to these athletes, how do you know if someone wants to be your friend versus they just want to know you for your celebrity status? And I remembered this as I got to meet the basketball players. The response that was in that article said, if they ask me about anything except basketball, or if they ask me about my life in any way except for football, I know they're interested in me as a friend. If all they want to talk about is the sport I play, I know that they have no interest in me as a person. So as you meet people, get to know them. Ask them about their likes, their dislikes. Where are they from? Where'd they grow up? How do they like living in this town as opposed to the town they grew up in, whether it was larger, smaller, whatever? Get to know them. Ask questions about them. Show an interest in them. Think about people that you have known for at least 2 years. Have you ever talked about Jesus with them? Anyone in your life, everyone in your life that you've known for 2 years, have you ever talked with Jesus about them? Do you have trouble loving yourself? Have you been beaten down by life or the people that were supposed to love you? Are you hurting? Do you have a personal relationship with your Creator? The best and easiest way to love yourself is to love your Creator. Because your Creator loves you greater than anyone on this earth ever will, ever can. He loved you enough that Jesus chose to die for you. We celebrated that through the last series and last week on Easter. Jesus died for you. He chose to die for you because he loved you. Don't ask the question, how can God love me? Just know that he does love you. He can love you because he created you. He formed you. He knit you together in your mother's womb. I love that verse in Psalm 139, it says, God knit me together in my mother's womb. He was actively involved in your creation. He was actively involved in your growth before you were even born. He says to Jeremiah, before you were born, I called you as a prophet to the nation. Before you were born, God was involved in your life. Before you were conceived, before your great-great-great-great-great-great-grandparents were received or were conceived themselves, God sent Jesus to die for you. As well as all of them, yes, but for you. What are you going to do with Jesus? How are you going to love yourself? How are you going to love God God and love your neighbor. We're going to get into more physical, more practical ideas in the coming weeks. And as we draw closer to our summer of fun. But I want you to be thinking about this. My challenge to you this week is get to know someone. Meet some people that you haven't met before. Or maybe, you know, they are literally the neighbor and they live next door to you or across the street or something. And you've never had more than a conversation with them. Reach out to them. Get to meet them. Take them a pan of muffins. Say, hey, I was making some, I made too much. Would you like some cornbread? Would you like some blueberry muffins? Would you take them? What are you willing to do to reach people for Jesus? You've got to meet them and get to know them. Are you willing to do that starting this week? I know for some people it is uncomfortable and it is frightening and it is scary to think about doing that. That's okay. Start this week and practice. Practice meeting people. Go to somebody you know somewhat from work or from the neighborhood or from church and say, hey, we've talked a few times. I know your name, but I don't know you. Where'd you grow up? And just have a conversation with them. Doesn't have to be long, doesn't have to be hours long. Just 3 minutes, 5 minutes. It's practice for when we go out this summer to meet people. So let's be excited about loving our neighbors. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity that you are giving us to love our neighbors. Lord, this is a command we should be obeying every day. Help us to do this, Lord. Father, as we look forward to the summer of fun, don't let us get the idea we have to wait until then to start meeting people. Let us do that this week. Let us meet people. Let us talk to them. Let us invite them to church. Let us get to know people. Let us find out ways we can meet needs. Help us, Lord. Guide us. Be with us. Father, I just pray that your hand will be upon us as we meet people, that we will have the opportunities, Lord, to lead people to Jesus, to invite people to know you as Savior and Lord, and to invite people to come and join us here at this church. Join our family, for there's always room for more. Help us with this, Father. We pray this, Lord, in your name. Amen. Lord, as our praise team comes to lead us in a song, we're going to sing about the joy of the Lord. Let that fill you and infuse you as we prepare to go and as we prepare to live out in the world for Jesus. Let's stand as we sing.
Strength. He will uphold me all of my
Let's say our scripture verses. It talks about loving our neighbor. When he saw the crowds, he felt compassion for them because they were weary and worn out, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is abundant, but the workers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest." Thank you very much. You're dismissed. Go in the joy of the Lord and love your neighbors.